Welcome everybody. I'm here with Alex and Peter. Patrick. Sorry. And they come all the way from Germany, and they have an organization called the
Nation of Ephraim.
The Nation of Ephraim, an alliance group to the Jewish people and understanding the truth and going deeper into what is going on in this world. Where is the truth? What does Hashem want from us in our day and age? They have made the long and expensive trip.
Yes, really.
Very expensive trip from Germany to Eretz Yisrael, here in the Holy Land. And we are here to talk about their organization and our efforts as well, and how we can help each other bring the Geula, bring the redemption into this world as Hashem wants. And of course, to see how, you know, we can be, you know, Hashem's children and get along, just like our parents always want us to get along, to see how we can get along in the spiritual sense, and of course to take a few minutes of our day, all of us, and try to help in the public and the Geula Kolis and the general redemption, and see what we can do. So Bakasha, Alex, how are you doing? How is your trip? And what do you bring with you to Israel? Like, what great message is it? What do you bring? What call of the Surah?
So, as I said, my name is Alexander Horn, for everyone that don't know me. And I'm in the Nation of Ephraim for 5 years. So, before the time, I did not know anything about the Bible, Torah, God, nothing. So in 2017, I met Ephraim, so Ulf Diebel, and he taught me everything of the Bible. So that means for 5 years, I am reading the Bible, of course, and you read about Israel. So you read about the people of Israel, you read about Eretz Israel, the land of Israel, so it's like the whole book is just about Israel. And so it's a really great honor to be here after preparing 5 years in my own life to come here. So, and I thank Hashem for being here together with Patrick. It's was a troubling journey, I can tell you. It was really not easy to get here to the flight and in a hostel and so on. So 3 days ago we met our lovely Rabbi Abraham Feld, and he said, if you want to possess the land, you have to suffer. So that makes everything a bit easier to understand why sometimes things happens to you. So
yeah, because the merit, you know, you might not have enough merits, spiritual merits, to be here. So Hashem sometimes quickly, okay, you want to come, okay, but you have to suffer quick.
Yes.
To get in.
Yes, know? Yes, you can describe it as it feels like that. What he said.
Okay, and Patrick, how was your trip, and what do you, you know, how's your experience here? What do you bring with you, and what's your message?
So, okay, my message, first of all, my name is Patrick Geisler. I grew up in the former GDR, in the deepest socialism, without any education about religion and God and Bible and all the higher stuff. So, but I realized that there's a big lie. And I don't know how big this lie is, but I search for the truth. So I try to find out the facts. And today I'm, so I, like I said, so I have nothing to do with Torah and Bible, but at one point I realized, so you have to take a look in the Bible. So because I realized that God is real, so because I see the evil on earth, so, and this evil was for me a very satanic stuff, and it was for me a disgusting knowledge what Hashem is showing me, what is the reality, and after that nothing was normal, and I try to find people that understand the same issue and wants to fight against this, and the only way to do this is I learned that it's Bible and Torah. Yeah, so it's I try to go away, so when I can, when I see when someone is showing you the evil, then you have to fight against this, and this is only possible with Bible and Torah. And Ephraim did a lot of light into me. Yeah, so because I see some stuff when I started my research, but it's what's like some puzzles, and the puzzle come together with the Ephraim. Thanks, Ulf. And so in the end, it was possible to write an anti-Semitism report. So I think it's, in my opinion, a strong weapon to write some truths in a book. And you can give this to another one to showing him, here, this is a light. When you see, you live in darkness, and here, so we can see the light. And now I'm here in Israel. It's a long journey for me, about 20 years now, and that is the only place in the world so you can fight against anti-Semitism, because anti-Semitism means war. So you can see this especially here in Israel mostly every day. And at the end, the solution is here in Israel, and the solution is to finish a war. You have to make peace. Yeah, so that's the only way. And there's no place on earth like this for that. And so in the future, hopefully we will see a lot of peace between brothers, sisters.
Yeah, yes,
and so on. Yeah,
I wanted to say that, like, your book, even though it sounds like anti-Semitism report, it's like, but at the end of the day, it's a clarification of the situation,
yeah,
which brings, of course, clarification brings peace, brings knowledge, brings light,
yeah,
to the situation. So we can never deal with an issue unless we know that it's there and we have to address the issue. So this is like a reality check for the people that are connected to the report from either angle,
yeah,
you know, to check themselves and to be real, because, you know, like, you go to a doctor, knowing the issue is half the solution, you know. So first the diagnostic. So I appreciate that.
Yeah.
And in Europe, it's needed, I'm sure.
Much more. Hopefully, it will be a bestseller.
So you want to give a? Why don't you show us an example of something? Yeah, the cover and maybe.
The cover. So we can take this. It's our logo from our nation of Ephraim. This is the anti-Semitism report. We call this From Darkness to Light, because now we are in the biblical end times. You can see a lot of people are waking up. Yeah? But when they're waking up, what means this? So they are waking up from what? This is a question. And especially to what? Yeah, to what are you waking up? So you came out of the dead. Yeah, when it comes to life. So in this book, it's written for those people, so they are waking up, yeah, and need a direction. Yeah, thank you. Direction, so where they can go. So, and when you want to come live in truth, then you have to know the lie, how it's working. And
let's see, the eagle is a menorah as well?
Yes.
Ah, okay, so it's the German eagle?
Yes, a little story. Everyone that knows the Deutsch-Israelische Gesellschaft, the German-Israeli society or alliance, had a logo with half an eagle. So the eagle is the thing of
symbol.
The symbol of Germany, and the menorah, of course, the symbol of the Jewish people. So they had the idea, and they won a prize for that logo with half an eagle and half a menorah. So, in the beginning, when we were not that far as we know, if you can see the book, it really looks good. So we move forward, we get better day to day. So, but before we used their logo, so after 2.5 years, there was some complication with copyright, of course. So we decided to make a new logo. We said, okay, no, there is no half eagle and no half menorah. We will make the simple ones, because our mission, especially our mission that we are here from the nation of Ephraim, here in the land of Israel, is really to make the peace mentioned in Jeremiah 31, the new covenant between Ephraim and Yehuda. So that is since 5 years really our mission. So we came here to met some Jewish people, of course, because we are from Ephraim, they are from Yehuda, and the best way to start peace is by one-to-one individuals. So if two people can manage, two human beings can manage to make peace, everyone can do it. So, and so the logo, the symbol, was made unified, and the half menorah and the half eagle became one. Phoenix, enlightening the whole menorah, because the phoenix also, there are some theories if phoenix is it real or is it just a myth, but the phoenix is the symbol of the restoration, the Geolah. It's also a symbol of all the things bringing together all Israel, the 12 tribes, and so on. So it was the perfect logo for our purpose.
So it's interesting, because whether it's a true, whether it's a myth or it's real, that's, I guess, up to us. You know, are we gonna be Matzliach? Are we gonna be successful in creating unity? Sabra, that's the question of the day. Okay, so let's talk about the significance in this time for this kind of situation. Now, the Rebbe, years ago, maybe 30, 40 years ago, already started talking about, to his chassidim, to his followers, spread the word about the seven laws of Noah, and universal seven laws of Noah, and the Rebbe wanted it translated to every single language, and the Rebbe also said that the Jews are also children of Noah. Noah is the father of everyone. And these laws, there was the six laws that God gave Adam. And at the time, they were not eating meat. Only when Noah got off the ark, they started eating meat. And it's the seventh law, which is to do not kill, do not eat from an animal while it's still alive. So that's the seven laws together of Noah. Do not kill, do not steal, respect God, respect the family life, do not curse God, I think, establish courts of justice, and okay, I don't know everything about that, I have to check, but the core, it's the same thing almost as the Ten Commandments, just missing Shabbos and a few other things. But at the end of the day, I want to make this also interesting, clear, that the truth is that the seven laws of Noah is a gate to the 613 laws, and it's a gate to the entire Torah, at the end of the day. This is something I want you to... So, even though Judaism is kind of, you know, it's already, you're in the palace, kind of, right? The seven laws of Noah, if you really break them down, and you keep peeling the onion, as they say, you will find everything in the Torah is in there as well. And of course, you know, there's many debates between many non-Jews that I know, whether they can help the Jewish people more if they're not Jewish, which usually is the case. Because being Jewish has its own challenges. And, you know, it is what it is. But the thing that I'm saying is, each of us has a special mission in the world. Each of us has, like we said earlier, the Geula Pratis, the private Geula that he's being redeemed from. And this is also, we see the order in the Torah is also part of the Torah. And we see that Noah comes first, which he was just a righteous man. 120 years he was building the ark, roughly speaking, and not one person did he convince to join him on the ark. Only him and his family. And that's the first step. That's the first step of bringing Hashem's light back to the world. First of all, we need to be an example. The best way to influence others is not to talk so much and not to this. It's just be an example, living, walking. It says in the Shema, in the, you know, Hear, O Israel, God is our God. And it says, "Vishinantam levanecha vidibarta bam," you shall teach your children. And right after that it says, when you're sitting in your house, v'shiftecha beritzecha, when you're going, when you're sleeping, when you're waking up, what's the connection? It's because your kids are not learning from you when you go like this. Here, study, study. They're watching you when you're sitting, when you're walking, when you're sleeping. That's how the kids learn. So if you're wondering why your kids are not behaving, it's because they're looking at you. It's because you can't expect them to be different. So we have to teach it by example. So Noach was the first step. First of all, he was a righteous man in his day. And then Avraham was the next step, which he prayed even for the people of Sodom not to die. But when God told him there isn't even 10 people righteous in the city, then he turned it over. But even that, why did Avraham stop praying when there was no righteous people? Because he said, if there's no righteous people, in his mind, he wasn't trying to be evil, but how could they have a merit to exist? He couldn't see, so God said he stopped praying. That's it. It's over. Moses was even the third step, which is even higher, which is when the Jews sinned with the golden calf, Moses said, yeah, they are Rishon, they are evil for what they did. They have sinned. So what? God, have mercy on them. They are your children. The Egyptians will say you brought them out to the desert to kill them here. You promised them you will take them to the land. Okay. You know. So Moshe Rabbeinu, he prayed even for those who are not righteous. Specifically, because even if we have a brother or sister or parents sometimes, which in our eyes are not righteous, but so what? We still have to see in if we can figure out to find some love in our hearts for them and to find the forgiveness and so on. And because at the end of the day, we cannot change other people. We have to see the redemption from in ourselves, and only like that it can move out. So that's that. The seven laws of Noah, again, is like the gate to the rest of the Torah. Again, because in the details, like we said, the oral tradition, you break down the oral tradition and you'll find more and more details in every, it's like there's one law and then, you know. Yeah. So like they say, the seven laws of don't kill, don't steal, you know, don't steal is kidnapping. It's not just stealing things. The Tolda, from what we learned, don't kidnap. Like when a cop puts you in a car, that's stealing. That's kidnapping. So that's the first don't steal. Later, it's do not steal actual items from people. That's the tool from that. Anyway, so that's about the seven laws of Noah. So we're working, let's go more to the mission that we're doing. We're working on seeing practically what the next step that Hashem would want us to do in the process, like we spoke about earlier, of the redemption. And we are right now focusing on establishing the Sanhedrin.
Excuse me, when yes. You say we, for the visitors, the viewers, who is we?
Who is we? So we have a group called the Beis Havad L'Chachamim, the Jewish Congress of the Wise, something like that, it's a rough translation, and we are collecting Jewish rabbis from different groups, Chabad, Ashkenaz, different groups of rabbis, and we're bringing them together for the purpose of cooperating for the greater good of Am Yisrael. So Beis Havad L'Chachamim is the group of the rabbis. Now we have the Lion and the Lamb group, which is the advisors, the Yotzi, because the Sanhedrin is going to need to know the customs and the rituals and the ways of all the nations in order to be able to judge them properly. And this is where the advisors come in. And the advisors don't necessarily need to be Jewish either. So you have the judges, the Shoftim, and then you have the Yotzi and the advisory board. So we have many people like Hans, your friend, which is in the Lion and the Lamb group, which are also giving us advice and input and helping us, really, in more ways than one, to create the infrastructure for the Sanhedrin and to give us the correct direction and support in different ways of how to do this correctly. You know, and in order, again, the Sanhedrin's job is also a peacetime job. Mm-hmm. We see that Sanhedrin is when the Jewish people are in a good situation can the Sanhedrin exist. It's like a delicate flower. It's like it's like a special gift. Like you never see the Sanhedrin pop up when there's a war or when there's a fight. This is Sanhedrin is like it's like the spiritual, it's like the godly expression of Judaism into the world through the wisdom of the Torah, you know, and then their corrected translation with, you know, the Shekhinah's presence involved, and so on. So right now what we're doing is the Rambam explained, and I didn't fill you in on this part, but the Rambam says that the way to re-establish the Sanhedrin in our day is to create an organization of Rov Chachmei Yisrael, the majority of the rabbis of our generation, and we just threw a rough number of, let's say, 10,000 rabbis, but they have to represent all of the Jewish people, so that when the Beis Havad says one thing, all the Jews will feel that this is connected to them and follow what the Beis Havad says. And when we have that kind of rabbinical congress, and then they'll be able to establish the Rosh HaSanhedrin, the head of the Sanhedrin, because, and then he'll be able to create the 70 selected, which will be the foundation for crowning a Jewish king, and building the temple, and doing all the commandments that Hashem really wants us to do, the full expression, like we said earlier, of the 613 commandments, not just the 87 that we're doing in exile. So the Beis Havad is the first step, getting the rabbis to work with one another and respect one another, which is, you know, again, the reason for the destruction of the temple was because of Sinas Chinam, because of hate. And when Yaakov had the dream, when he was going and he saw the angels going up and down, he saw the future, and Hashem showed him the end of the exiles. So he saw the end of the Babylonian exile. He saw the end of these four exiles, and we're now in the last exile of Edom, and he didn't see the end, and Jacob started to cry because he didn't see the end of the exile, and God said, don't worry, it's going to work out at the end. This is also the promise that God gave to Noah, that the world will never be destroyed again. God showed him the symbol of the rainbow and said, this is my promise between me and you, that I will not destroy the world. And
today it's perverted.
But it's actually interesting because they use the rainbow as their flag, and that's the only thing holding Hashem from destroying the world. Yes. Is the promise he gave to Noah that he won't destroy the world.
It's also a symbol. The rainbow is also a symbol that he destroyed the wicked people before.
Yeah. Noah was actually not interested in having kids after the flood. Because he said, we're going to populate the earth, and again we're going to make a mistake, and again. So I asked him, no. This time they're going to get it together. Mm-hmm. This time humanity is going to work itself out. And this is Hashem, being the creator of the world, of heaven and earth, told Noah. So, and that's why Noah was very excited. And at the time he thought, maybe we need to get drunk. And that's why we weren't successful last time. So he got drunk, and then his son, Ham, castrated him. And then he cursed Ham that you will be a slave to your brothers because you stopped me from having a child to serve me. That's what Noah said. You stopped me from having a child to serve me. When I was a kid, I was offended. To serve me? What am I? But you stopped me. So you will be a servant to your children, to your brothers. And that's the Africans in general, we know. That's their blessing for the last. But now, before the redemption, things are loosening up. There's a lot more mercy from Hashem. Things are changing, and we have to. At the end of the day, and Chassidus explains the whole purpose for creation is in order to create a system where we have free choice, and we don't see God, and we choose God. It's like today we have the movies. I can make an animation that says, "Oh, long live the king" to me, and put it on replay, and I have a video of me being the king. It's not fun. It's annoying, right? Only when there's free choice, Hashem created, he makes that his light is not shown so that we think that we have free choice. And we have the illusion of free choice to a certain extent. And then in that illusion, when we choose to crown Hashem as king, that's what Hashem wants. So that's what we're here for. That's why the darkness is here. And that's the advantage of the dark, the light, the sunrise. You know, if you have a white piece of paper, it's not interesting, right? But if you have the sunrise and you see all the colors and the orange and the red, that's when it's interesting. So the Yisra Na'or Habamin HaFeshach, the advantage of the light which comes out of the darkness, this is what's so special. This is This is Hashem's plan. This is not our world. We just have to figure out what we need to do. You know, this is how Hashem wants it to be. And, you know, the Shekhinah going down, the Rebbe says, how can, you know, when Adam sinned with the tree of life and the, you know, the Chet Eitz Hadas, the sin when he took from the tree and so on, the dark Hashem, you know, it's like Hashem's light went out of the world one step. And then when Cain killed Hevel, the brothers, another step. And then the light went up seven heavens. And then when Avraham was born and he started to open his tent and, you know, bring people in, so that brought the light down one level. And then finally the light is seven generations till Yitzchak, Yaakov, and then, you know, the tribes, Yosef and everything. And then eventually in Mount Sinai, in Matan Torah, the light was down here. Boom, we got the Torah. And it's interesting because from Abraham till Moses is seven generations. And then from Moses to David is seven generations. Mm-hmm. So we have this pattern, but the thing is the struggle is always there. The light of Hashem is trying to come into our world when we relax and stop killing each other and start to learn the Bible. It's not so bad.
You know? What I find very interesting is Yahushua. After Moses died, he gave Yahushua the Torah and he brought all Israel in the land. He was in the 33rd generation, just like David. But David was born, I don't know, 200, 300 years later.
Yeah.
So, but they were all, both of them, the
33rd. It's a Freemason number, huh?
Yes.
Well, if we're talking about three, then.
David is the king in the king. Everyone says, and Yahushua brought Israel finally in the land.
Right, we can talk about Yahushua also, because Yahushua, like, the whole Bible is the drama, is the, what are we doing? No action. You know, the generation of the desert, they die in the desert. And the Korach wants to run ahead, you know, like a rich guy. Where's the money? And he's running too fast. And the Meraglim, the spies, they want to stay in the pray and learn and study. They don't want to leave. They're so calm. But what was the Korach found what he was good at, and the Meraglim found what they were comfortable. But they forgot what Hashem was doing. Hashem's like, what's going to help you if you want to stay in the clouds of glory when it's time to take over the land, the Holy Land of Israel? So once you separate yourself from the will of Hashem, you can't call yourself, you're not connected to Hashem, you know? So even if you're studying, we have to always see what has Hashem want from us at the time. There was even a time when the Jews said, we want a Jewish king. They told the prophet, we want a Jewish king. But they said it because they didn't want to hear the prophet talking. The prophet was speaking too much truth and it was bothering them. So they didn't want a king for the sake of heaven. They didn't want a king because that's what Hashem wrote in the Torah. And that's a commandment, and we want to fulfill a commandment of Hashem. They said it because, so today, we really have to check ourselves, really have to dig deep into our soul, and see, are we ready to take Hashem as our king, and do what Hashem wants in the Torah? You know, if it's established a king. And not because it fits, and it's our group, and it's our community, and it's this, and it's that. It's because Hashem wants it, that's it. You know, and can we work together towards that end? Yahushua, very quickly, he conquers Israel. So this is like the generation of Mashiach. This is like the generation, like in my mind, it's like the Rebbe passed away, and we don't see the Rebbe with our physical eyes. And for us, it's a very big darkness as well. But the Rebbe gives us license, and the Rebbe gives us, as the leader of the Jewish people, gives us permission and asks us and urges us to push forward with the mission of creating the Geula in this world. And we're the generation of the Geula. We're like the generation after the drama. We're just going to get it done, hopefully. We'll be simple and humble enough. You know, and the generation of the desert, every summer they bury themselves in the sand, and they wanted to see if it's their year to die. Because Moses said, you guys are all going to die in the desert for the sin of the golden calf. But a few of them did not die in the desert. Yahushua ben Nun, and if you call it Ben Yefune, they went and they led the Jewish people into the next generation. So this is what the older generation needs to ask themselves. Are they ready to be bittle, humble enough and get over the traumas and whatever they're working through and join the younger generation that has nothing to lose, kind of, and we just want the redemption. Are they ready to do that? Or are they going to, the ego and their pride get in the way and they're just going to die in the desert? Because I'm sure that the parents in the desert, you know, their kids, they wanted them to join them. You know, it's impossible. You can think about it. You see your parents going to kill themselves pretty much every year in the summer. And some of them come back, some of them don't. It was a horrible thing. And I'm sure that the kids tried. But the question is, can the older generation, like I'm talking to, like, you know, the older generation of the desert, can you get your act together? We really don't want you to lose out. We're going to move towards the redemption. We just need Ahavat Yisrael, Ahavat Chinam, love your fellow as yourself, respect your fellow as yourself unconditionally, just like we spoke about earlier, Yosef forgiving his brothers for selling him in the pit. You know, that's what we need now. And I'm so happy again, we've made alliances in the past. By the way, we've made alliances with different groups and different videos that we made, Holocaust survivors, and we have a friend from Cyprus we spoke to about Christianity, but he's like very, you know, holding on to Christianity very strong. It's okay, you know, to each his own. It's all, again, like we said, steps out of the exile, each one with his, you know, time and place. You know, you can't make fun of a kid when he's in first grade, you know, just because he's in first grade or second grade. Each one, you know, one step out. But the point is, it's very good. This is the best thing that I'm sure Hashem is happy that, you know, his kids are getting along. And we are creating history right now. This is what we're doing.
I've heard there's a Jewish joke. So the only one who can join every Jew together is Moshiach. And if every Jew is gathered together, you don't need Moshiach anymore.
I have another joke, but it's not as spiritual as a kid asks his father, a Jewish guy, can I get $5? So the father says, $4? What do you need $3 for? That's like today in the economy. Inflation is going so fast. Anyway, so the point is that we, achdus, getting along, accepting each other, especially when we're different. Like, what can be more different than Germans and Jews and this? Like, yes. Well, you know.
We were on a conference for 3 days, so yesterday was the last day, and one speech of a Jewish guy, I think from England, inspired me really, because the things that he said, the topic was also anti-Semitism, they are equally like the things we deal with. So what did he say? He said, okay, in the Germans, because on the conference, at least half of it were Germans, he said, okay, you are Germans. You speak German, you live in Germany, and your political thing is German nationalism. So now here, we are the Jewish people, we live in the state of Israel, we speak Hebrew, and our political mission is Zionism. So in this, the conference, as I said, was about the topic of anti-Semitism. And what he wants to
convey,
yes, is that anti-Semitism, as the word was used for 20 years, can today isn't working anymore. Because, you know, we, like you said, we live in the fourth exile of Rome, of
Edom.
So, and it all started with Babylon. So Babel means confusion. So, and the confusion of the words, when God started to spread all the nations and gave them different tongues. So the confusion of the words is, in our opinion, the most important thing to understand. Then, just as he said, so they are the Jewish people, they speak Hebrew, they live in Israel, and they are Zionists. So, from our perspective, you had, of course, Jacob, and then he became Israel, and he had the 12 tribes of Israel. So they were always Israel. So they, Israel was given the Torah, Israel was led by Moshe, Israel was going to the land with Yehoshua.
Bnei Israel, the children of Israel. Yeah.
Yes, yes. So until the point when Solomon got ripped off the half of the kingdom because of his idolatry.
Idolatry, yes.
Yes. And then the things start to get a little bit confusing, because the Northern Kingdom, the 10 tribes, today they are known as the 10 Lost Tribes, so they were exiled. So this was about 2,700 years ago. So the southern part, with the Judah and Benjamin and half of Levi and maybe all of tribes, but so they had to go to Babel. They came back after 70 years, they built the second temple, and after the Romans destroyed the second temple, they had also go to the exile. So this southern kingdom is known today as the Jewish people. And if we say, okay, we are from Ephraim, so but we are non-Jews, for most of the people, even Jews, also as non-Jews, it's hardly to understand that we all belong to the ancient Bnei Israel. So we really are brothers, the Jewish Yosef and the non-Jewish Patrick and Alex, we are really brothers. So, and the re-establishing of the fully 12th tribe kingdom of Israel in the land of Israel with the king of Israel and so on, building the temple, that is really our mission, to spread a bit anti-confusion about using words, because a lot of people today say that Jews and Israel and Hebrews and Semites, it's all the same, it doesn't matter, it's all the same, but it's really not true. So Abram was a Hebrew, so, and with Israel we have the people of Israel.
Right, and the reason also, that I'll explain you why we call the Jewish people the Jewish people, even though, like you said, there were earlier Hebrew and, you know, earlier, you know, other names. That's also a good way of putting it, but I'll give you another point of view. In the Megillat Esther, the story of Purim, so we have the story of Mordechai, which was from the tribe of Benjamin. But he's called Ish Yehudi, he's called a Jewish man. Why is he called a Jewish man? Because he was putting himself in danger by not bowing to Haman, which had the idol on his neck, and wanted to kill the Jews. He was from Amalek. So when Mordechai put himself in danger, like we said, we explained earlier about Yehuda being the highest level of self-sacrifice for Hashem, so the Jews are, oh, Yehudi, Yehudi, Ish Yehudi. He's like Yehuda, self-sacrifice. And the Rebbe goes deep into this concept of self-sacrifice and tries to find, where did Yehuda get this ability to self-sacrifice on such a crazy level? And the Rebbe says, Yehuda got it from Avraham Avinu, from his grandfather, Abraham. When Hashem told Abraham, go kill your son, right? Put him on an altar and kill your son. This was the highest level of self-sacrifice you can ask of a person. Because you can ask someone to kill himself, he'll do it. But if you ask him to kill his kids, he won't do it. This is how we know, out of a hostage situation, they go and they get a kid, right? So, this is the highest level of self-sacrifice known to man. And Avraham Avinu passed this test. And the Rebbe says that ever since Avraham Avinu passed this test, of course, Hashem didn't want him to kill Hashem didn't want him to kill his son. It was just a test. But ever since that, Am Yisrael, the nation of Israel, has this embedded in them. The ability to do self-sacrifice higher than understanding. And like, and you can imagine what Isaac felt like. Imagine you're a kid and you're like, oh, I'm disposable, you know? Yes. It doesn't matter if I'm here or I'm not here. This is the also bittul. This is being humble to the biggest degree, when you feel like Hashem runs my life, Hashem runs my show, so much so I'm insignificant, that it doesn't matter if I'm here or not. It's like, it's exactly the opposite of, and this is the kind of, and all this for what? All this for what? All this, like we said, for the Ten Commandments, for the Bible, is a Hashem's gift to humanity of how to you know, it says Hashem looked at the Bible and created the world. Everything matches it. That's why it brings so much peace to us when we study the Torah, because it makes sense. It fits. It works. You know, and like we said about Shabbat, which is the first, you know, fight for freedom that Hashem gives humanity, is stop working, go home, go take a nap, go pray. And in the Talmud, there's actually a discussion. Someone that goes to pray and study and all day on Shabbat, he's busy running around like a chicken. So is he fulfilling Shabbat more, or is somebody that's just sitting at home and resting? You know, because Hashem said to rest.
Yes. You know?
So I think they say that the person who's resting is more fulfilling Shabbat the way Hashem meant it. But you know, I don't know if that's the halacha, that's the law. Of course, we should go to pray, and of course, we should remember Hashem and everything. But the point is that we were working again, like we said earlier, towards the redemption. We're trying to close the gaps. And of course, right now, the world is, you know, the good is gravitating towards the good side. It's like, you know, I have a pool. You have a certain chemical you put in, all the garbage goes down. So, and then you can clean it. You're familiar with it?
Yes.
So now, right now, we're having a situation like that in the world. The evil is just running towards the evil. All the, you know, all the bad angels are flying, and the good is coming, and it's amazing, because, like, according to Hasidus, we have the world of holiness in the higher worlds is called Olam HaTikun, the world of fixing, of order, and Olam HaTohu blows up, and Nitzutzos are flying all over the place, and sparks, you know. And this is an allegory, this is an example, obviously. This is not, we're saying it in language that people can understand, but this is just an example. But the point is that from the Olam HaTikun, it falls out a few drops into the Tohu, into the chaos. And this is, in Judaism, we call them Chasidei Umat Olam, the Chasidim, the kinder people throughout the world, in the world, these sparks of holiness that emerge, and they come back, and they actually help the Jews throughout the exile, wherever they go. And now the world, see, that's also one thing. The reason for the exile is so that the Jewish people can start a certain kind of a process of purification throughout the world. At the end of the day, again, Hashem loves all of His children. The Jews are just like the B'ni B'chari, the firstborn, like the older kids. Sometimes you want to talk to the younger kids, you can't. You talk to the older one, you tell them, don't tell everybody else to come back home, right? So this is like the Jewish people, even if you look historically, like when the Judaism starts and then Christianity and Islam, of course we can say, well, my life is only 120 years old, or, you know, 30 years old back in the day. But the point is that if we're looking at thousands of years of, you know, like we said, processing what Hashem's will is in this world, the Jewish people are like the older brother. And that's why their job is to be a light unto the nations. This is their job. If they're not doing it, it's a problem. This is why I say, like, the Rebbe was so so pushing, and this is why I also made my website and why I'm here right now. Because, you know, all the connections. Because the Rebbe said we have to advertise and proclaim, we have to push the message out. Because if not, then, like, what happened in, you know, Germany is, like, propaganda, oh, the Jews are devil worshippers. Okay, fine, you know. Well, the Jews are devil worshippers. Yeah, let's go kill them. You know, it's that easy, right? So if the Jews are not actively involved in not just spreading light in their own community, and this I'm talking to my fellow Jews, but also bringing light to the darkest places, like I told our friends here, that they have an advantage because they're in the darkness. They're in Europe. They're in a place where, like, it's documented. There's anti-Semitism. There's issues that need to be resolved. You know, hate without a reason and this kind of thing. So that light, to bring it to those places, that's the mission. You know, that's the job. And Be'ezrat Hashem, we have to talk about it, and we know today the power of spreading the word, spreading the message. And I'm very happy, and the Hans, I spoke about many times, very sophisticated fellow, very practical also. I like his style, you know. And of course, it's a new age, you know, today, like, 100 years ago, this would never happen because we would never have a way to know But again, today everybody knows exactly, like the algorithm, you know? Mm-hmm. It knows exactly what you want, and the more you push over there, the more you go. So that's why it's important today to be involved in good things. Because yes. Whatever you want, it's gonna, you know, you're gonna get everything you want. So you better be on a good track. So, but this also gives us the advantage of finding like-minded people, not people that are, ready to think about new things, new partnerships. I can imagine in 100 years what we're doing now. Thinking, oh yeah, that's when the Germans started helping the Jews. You know, yeah, whatever. It's like, but now it's like, what are we doing? What's happening here?
Yes. So everyone that knows Torah sees the world around us, and it really seems stark. It seems like it never stops. So I think the best thing we can do is really come closer. Yeah. Come closer together, and we have to unite each other, that we become really the 12th tribe kingdom of Israel again. Because World War II, Joseph told me before, after World War II, a lot of Jews, they threw their kippah out and said, I don't want to do this again. How can God do such thing to us? So, and the rabbi in that time was some kind of light. So to see the positive thing of all these terrible things that happens to the Jews in the Holocaust, and also to the Germans, if you say, okay, how many burning bombs were German cities were wiped out? So the positive thing to see something positive in the terrible was that after that, the German, like Isaac Herzog, the president of the State of Israel, was 2-3 days ago in the German Bundestag and gave a speech. And he also said 75-80 years after that what happened in World War II, the Germans and the Jewish people, State of Israel and Germany, they are connected. They are deeply connected, and they will never ever separate, because what happened after World War II is also that these two groups, I would say, the Germans, the Jews, they found a way, more a secular way, but they found a secular way to make peace. So we saw this on the conference, because there were a lot of Jews and Germans and German Jews, and it was more a non-religious peace. So now, if people would really understand why the Germans and the Jews has this deep connection, if they would understand that they really come, they have a common past, so, and not just to go back 70 years or 300 years when maybe Jews and Germans lived together and everything worked, beside the fact that the church and the equation was very terrible. But if you go far, far further, 2,700 years ago, 3,334 years ago, when we got Torah, I don't know which book is just the Torah, sorry. So if we start thinking in that dimensions, so I think also from our German side, we can feel more deeply connected to each other. So that I do not make peace with a Jew because I feel guilty what my forefathers did 70 years ago, and I just do this because our government says yes. The
virtue signaling. Yeah.
Yes. No. I really want to do this. There's a concept. A concept of fear and love. You need to fear God, and you need to love God. So if you fear God, but you don't have love, it's not complete. So, but if you just love Him and have no fear, it's like nothing. So, and on our side, that what we experienced, thanks to Ulf, to Ephraim, in the last 5 years, it was really just as it was written in Jeremiah 31, the New Covenant, when God said, okay, you are a royal, you became even the nations, you became a goyim, because I sent you out of Israel. I separated your connection with Torah. So, but now, after the time, in the time, and I would say we are...
In the days of Mashiach.
In the days of Mashiach, just right before the whole redemption.
Yes.
He said, okay, but I will show mercy on you, and I will put my spirit in your heart. So, most of the Jews were raised with Torah since they were born. So, we had nothing. So, if you're a Jew and you say, okay, I have done things wrong, I'm going to be a Baal Shuvah, so you know, if you're a Jew, where to go, where to find some truth. But if you're a German or somewhere in the European, New Zealand, anywhere in the world, you really do not know where to find. So, when I started my journey, I tried anything. I tried Buddhism, some kinds of esoteric, I even tried anything, but I never thought that I would find the truth in Judaism. So,
okay, yeah, one second, let me just check if everything's rolling, because sometimes, you know.
Yeah, we're good.
That's not good.
Okay.
That's amazing. Yeah, the Avraham Avinu had the same journey as well. Like when he was discovering Hashem, so he grew up. He was the stargazer said to Nimrod the king. He said, "There's a boy being born right now that's going to topple you and undermine your power." So the soldiers went to Abraham's father's house, Terach, and they said, "You have a boy here?" He's like, "A boy here?" And there was a different kid or whatever it was. He gave him some other kid, but his Avraham Avinu escaped with his life. And Avraham Avinu was born in a cave. For 3 years, he never left the cave. He was with his mother in the cave. And finally, after 3 years, he left the cave. And he's looking around and he sees the mountains. And he says, oh, the mountains are God. And then he sees somebody breaking the mountain. He says, no, that's not God. And then he sees the sun rise. He says, oh, the sun is God. He sees the sun go down. He says, oh, the sun is not God. The moon, oh, maybe the moon. And like this is like an example of, you know, like what you just said, your discovery, every person's personal discovery of Hashem is unique. And, you know, and like we say, it goes in the same footsteps of, like we see Avraham Avinu and his search. Again, we're talking, Avraham Avinu is beginning to bring the light of Hashem back down. So he's working in darkness. You know, he's figuring it out. And then once Avraham Avinu figures it out, only then does Hashem reveal himself to him. So Avraham Avinu doesn't get any revelation only until he already did the work that he had to do. So, you know, that's the journey that I like comparing it when you said that right away. I'm thinking. So I'm thinking, you know, there's a lot of, you know, in the Bible it says that the temple was a place, all the nations would come. And in Yom Kippur, the holiest day of the year, the Jewish people would slaughter 70 cows as a sacrifice to Hashem for the benefit and the welfare of all the 70 nations of the world. And again, because the Jewish people think, oh, the Jewish people are busy doing their own thing. No, we have a mission, a special, you know, a unique responsibility to be a light unto the nations and to be the holders of Hashem's, you know, Torah, to study it. And you know, throughout the generations, the Jewish people, how much they died for the Torah and self-sacrificed. And this mission, again, of course, obviously, we can't do it without our alliance, the friends, and the people that we join on the way. I also want to say another thing. Avraham Avinu, he had his tent, and if you ate from his tent, and he would speak about God and teach as much as he can. If you praised God when you ate, he would give it to you for free. But if you didn't want to praise God, he would charge a lot of money.
So he would say, well, who's going to give you food in the middle of the desert? So Avraham Avinu, just from him speaking about God and spreading the word, many people, they weren't Jewish necessarily, but they went on their way. They went to all over the world, tens of thousands of people, I would assume, throughout Avraham Avinu's lifetime. And they spread the word about Hashem, and they landed in all kinds of different places, and they already started the work of, you know, spreading Hashem's light in the world. And you know, then we have the story of Egypt and later and this and that. But and of course Shem and Eber, which is Shem is Melchizedek, is Noah's son, which lived for a couple hundred years. So him and his son Eber, they had the grandparents of Avraham Avinu, they had a yeshiva. They were teaching, studying Torah all the time. And Avraham Avinu studied in their yeshiva, like the first yeshiva, three people, you know. And then later, Yitzchak went to go study there. Yaakov wanted to study there. He also studied there, but then he had to run away because Esau was running after him. It was getting exciting. But there's a direct line of the heritage and everything going down. And even today, people that are not necessarily Jewish and like Jordan, Dr. Jordan Peterson, you know, a psychologist in Canada, very, very popular today. So he speaks about that the Bible, especially the Old Testament, is compact of so much information and so much wisdom that is just, you know, it's like there's a reason the Torah is so, you know, precious to the Jewish people. There's a reason why, you know, not one letter has to be, you know different. And, you know, hopefully we can, you know, this is like the last recipe book to make a good dessert, you know? If this is like the last book of how not to make something, but how we should live and survive and thrive in a healthy, morally, ethical, proper way. And, of course, there's nothing else that the Jewish people at this special time can do. They appreciate more than, you know, people like you that, again, of course, you're coming out of your own volition, out of your own way. It's like not the Jewish people didn't, you know, scream for, you know, someone to come. You guys did, you know, a lot of Hashem, I'm sure Hashem guided you and brought you to this place. But there's nothing more appreciated that the Jewish people at this special time than, you know, you guys reaching out to us and, you know, Ephraim is like that, is the child that Yosef named Ephraim, which is like Pro Revu, which I was plentiful when I was in Egypt. Mm-hmm. So Menashe, the first child, he named Ki Nishani Elohim Be'eretz Ani. God abandoned me in this foreign land. And Ephraim was the son when Yosef was finding a way to serve Hashem in this land of Egypt. And he was already starting to be successful in Egypt and in what he was doing, saving them from it. So, and maybe helping his brothers, I'm not sure. But Ephraim is the positivity that came after him finding himself lost in exile. So, it's a pleasure and an honor to meet with you guys and talk to you guys. I hope you also learned something, a few things, I don't know.
Yes.
from your visit here. But it's really an honor and it's a pleasure.
Before we stop, he mentioned Hannes before that, like he said, is an advisor. We have made this under the leadership of Hannes Antacek, this beautiful temple coins. So
we'll put it up on the graphic.
Yes. So everyone on German TV should already
be familiar.
Yes, and so this is our temple coin. I hope you see it well. This is the front side. You may know, recognize it as a third temple. And on the back side, so we have the 12 tribes of Israel with a symbol. So, according to the prophecy, I think it was of Jacob, that Jacob gave to his children. So this temple coin is one shekel. We say, okay, They are 7.77 grams, so that means it's 1 shekel. So this is the original amount to give for the temple. So as we all know, there is no temple right now, but we made something. So we're just not some guys who say anything. No, we really do new things to spread our message, to reach the goal. So on Ephraim Media Truth, we are responsible for publication and virtual real estate services. So on the other hand, we made the as well as there is a Jewish National Fund, so we made the Ephraim National Gold and Silver Trust. So
we're gonna have the websites and everything.
Yes,
and the links and everything.
Yes, I will give all these flyers. So the one is from all of the gold and silver stuff, because we said our two main goals is A, to reestablish the 12 tribe kingdom, and to make silver as world currency, because everyone that is familiar with economics knows, okay, our financial system is on the end, it's above the end. So right now we are here in Israel. So yesterday we went out for a meal. And in Germany, normally you go to a Turkish restaurant, so you have a plate with some grilled stuff and some vegetables and so on. And you maybe, for 5 to 10 years ago, you for two people, you paid 20 euros. So yesterday he came with the bill, about 350 shekel. So that means one meal for two persons with a little bit of meat and vegetables and so on. It was great meat, but made about 120 euro. So it's multiplied by 6. So for us as really poor Germans, it's a lot of money. So in Israel, there are things a bit better because of the really, really bad change of the euro. So, but in the end of the day, silver and gold is the only thing that is money. So every other stuff is credit.
It's God's money.
And yeah, if it's a shekel, then it means much, much more. Of course, there's certain biblical commandments that we're supposed to fulfill with a shekel.
Yes.
Like, machatz is a shekel. Do you have a half a shekel coin? Is there such a thing yet? There's a time of the year whenever Moshe Rabbeinu needed to count the Jewish people, everyone needed to give a half a shekel, machatzit a shekel, and half because you're only one with Hashem, you're only one with fellow man, you know, always to remind us to be humble all throughout. For us to as the Jewish people, I'm just another guy, I'm not, the Rebbe himself, and if the Rebbe was revealed to us today, I would, tell the Rebbe, what do we do? Let's go, the people have spoken, we have an alliance, and we have people that are interested in empowering the Jewish nation to create the Geula. So let's go. And this is, of course, this is not a government. This is not a political party. I'm not part of any government. We the people. We the people with the free choice are collaborating in our time. And we're working together to do Hashem's will. And this is what we're doing. So, of course, I appreciate it. And on behalf of MN Global, my team, I thank you and all the people here. We're going to make a special prayer. I need the names of the mother and the person. So let's say Yosef ben Malka.
Okay.
Yosef son of so-and-so. Because that's how we pray for person's well-being. So we're going to try to work on that. Everyone that has a coin
yes
in here, we're going to
pray for them, which is the Jewish job, is to pray for people. Like Abraham Avinu, Hagat told him, whoever you bless will be blessed, and whoever you curse will be cursed. So we're going to definitely pray for the people here, and we're going to pray in specific places, specific times, at the site of Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, which is the founder of the Zohar, like we spoke about the secrets of the Torah, and perhaps at the temple in Jerusalem, at the Western Wall, Be'ezat Hashem. And of course, at this opportunity, I'd like to say that we'd be happy to teach Torah and to keep the communication open and to continue to study and learn and teach with your organization. And it's a great honor for us. Again, like I told you, you have an advantage because you reach an audience that is out of our, jurisdiction, out of our area. So for us, it's like, lighting the menorah in the darkest place. I was actually born on Hanukkah, on the second night of Hanukkah, in the winter, in the cold, in the darkness, so we said earlier about names and each person, connecting to his name. My birthday, I also relate to it as lighting dark in the darkness, So I'm very happy about this moment.
Perfect. So, for Israeli TV, from our nation, from our community, our nation of Ephraim, so everyone that wants to spend that temple coin, so he wrote his name on this case and put a coin I just showed you in there. So it's really for the temple. So we will give this now to Rabbi Yosef Edery, and he will keep it. So it's now in Israel. So für unsere deutschen Zuschauer, also ihr habt ja die Namen, wisst ihr, habt ihr da drauf geschrieben, ne, auf die Münze. Und die werden wir gleich dem Josef geben. Und er hat gesagt, wenn ihr den Namen eurer Mutter, euren Namen und den Namen eurer Mutter mir schickt, dann kann ich ihm eine Liste geben von eurem Namen mit dem Namen eurer Mutter, weil er gerne für euch beten würde, wenn ihr das möchtet. Und man macht das halt so, dass man euren Namen erwähnt und dann sagt, okay, Sohn oder Tochter von der Mutter, ne? From the mother.
Yeah.
Yes, von der Mutter. So, these coins, so they are just empty. So this is a gift from Hannes. So I'm just the bringer of the gift. So the gift is from Hannes. So that's for you, Rabbi.
Thank you.
And let's say you can do what you want to do. So you can give it to someone, you can sell it to someone. So maybe...
to support the work we're doing.
Yes, and maybe in the best opportunity is if you call us or you call Hannes in 2 weeks and you say, hey, your temple coin, that was so good, where can I buy more? So
yes,
that would be very great, because a business is also something that connects people. So one topic of the conference we have been was the Abraham Accords. So, and the Abraham Accords worked out so good because of business. Because business, in business there is no religion or race or anything, there's just business. So, let's make business for peace.
Right, so yeah, I would like to say that if someone needs to buy silver, and if someone is investing in silver, then what better way to do so than to do it with people who are supporting the building of the temple. Of course, in our, we all know the end of the story.
Yes.
You said, but now we need to reverse engineer this cake. We need to reverse engineer this exile. Like you said earlier also about the Tower of Babel being spread apart in different languages. That's because they were rebelling against Hashem, right? So Hashem said, I'm not going to kill them, but I'm going to destroy their unity.
Yes.
So now that we're done, hopefully the ones of us who are done fighting against Hashem, and those who want Hashem to be their king, the first thing we need to do is now start to reconstruct our unity to be able to face Hashem again
in cooperation. And of course, the temple coins. How can I? Now I'm biased. Now I'm biased. I'm part of the problem. But if you need to buy silver and you want to also support the Jewish people, bakasha. You do it with the temple coins. You'll find them online, and get your coins. Stock up. Inflation is coming. Invest in precious metals, and see you in the Beit HaMikdash.
Yes, the address. I hope you can see it. Maybe you can make a photo.
Yeah, we're gonna put them.
Templecoin.org.
Templecoin.org.
Yes,
and shipping worldwide.
Yes,
shipping worldwide.
Shipping worldwide. So, and now I'm really honored to give you this temple coins.
Thank you, and I ask Hashem to help me. I ask Hashem to help me with this new burden, this new mission,
yes,
to convert this into something, as we're going to discuss with you guys later, that will propel the redemption for the sake of Am Yisrael in a spiritual way, and for the sake of all of the entire world, for all the nations. Shkaya, thank you. Thank you, Patrick.
Thank
you. I got it now. Took me a while.
My last word.
Closing statements. I'm sorry.
Last word. So, for everyone didn't know, I'm from Ephraim YouTube, like I said. So, our main purpose is to collect everyone that talks about the Bible, Torah, Israel, all that stuff that makes Hashem happy, to say it so. And to give them a platform on the internet, publication and so on. So, and we think that our company, Ephraim Media Truth, will be the biggest company in the future world, because the main problem today is really fake news, mainstream media, because they are burning your head. So, and they have the absolute monopoly over all the world. So we just saw it on the conference, how they think about media. They sometimes believe their own lies. It's really terrible to look at this. So if we start together spreading the truth about God, about the tribes, about the Jewish people, about the confused German people, and so on, I think this can explode the monopoly of the media, and we have a really good, strong alliance that can crush all the lies that are around there. So, and
so it's like you're like your group is gonna push like Joe Rogan. Kind of Joe Rogan, but like for spiritual matters.
Joe Rogan
is the podcast, like the biggest podcast in the world.
Ah, okay.
Like the bald guy. I don't know.
He was an MMA fighter, right? Is this Joe Rogan?
Joe Rogan.
So he was an MMA fighter.
Yeah. So Joe Rogan, he makes podcasts. He speaks to people about, you know.
Yeah.
But here, your truth. What's it? Ephraim Media Truth. Flourishing in exile, trying to get out, pushing the truth, and hopefully you'll see me over there as well. We already have a few plans. We're going to make some videos,
and we will. He promised me before we will definitely have a continuance of that. We will go on together, and maybe we can handle to have a live stream once a week, or but we will have a cooperation together to just not end it. We go that way, he stays here and never talk of this again.
Yeah, so here they came all the way from Germany to my house.
Yes.
You know, I couldn't ask for anything better than that. When I just thought to walk outside. so this was a great meeting. Of course, this meeting is going to be the, you know, Yehuda's son, his name is Peretz, which means breaking through the boundaries. And the Rebbe uses Ufaratzta as the campaign to spread Judaism, to spread Mashiach, like an explosion, you know. So hopefully, with these kinds of alliances, slowly there won't be
much of an issue with the New World Order, with all the garbage that there is in the world. The light will start to set, you know, the truth will set you free,
yeah.
And truth media. So even for those who speak English, and for those in America, you might get your content over there, if you need that. And I know there's a lot of people that appreciate learning and studying. And for me, I just grew up, you know, I'm just talking, you know, for me, it's another day at the office. But for other people, it's very important, it's very enlightening. They want to hear what are the Jews, what are they hiding, what's going on? So here's the opportunity to get a sneak into the Jewish, into the Jewish people. It's like a yeshiva, but you don't have to sign up. You don't have to have the long pears and a yarmulke. You can just sit in your house and study Torah. What could be better than that? All right, Yofi.
Okay.
Closing statements. You want to say something?
So we have to come together. That's it. Yeah. So
where can they buy your book?
So on our platform. So we have a flyer. So beautiful flyer made by Alex. This is viable on Amazon. It is viable on our website. On
Zion, so anti-Semitism
report. 577.com. And everything we are with this report is for the fight against anti-Semitism. So this is not a private project. It's because
this is the first, would you recommend this as the first book for someone who is in Europe, let's say, and he wants to understand
yes.
the dynamics?
Yes, and it's the first book in my opinion that is working with the entire definition on anti-Semitism. They changed it from 2016 that anti-Semitism can be a joke against Jews and non-Jews. So, and with this context, so we open up the big picture for anti-Semitism. And it's, in my opinion, the way that we come together, because we will grow up the consciousness about that we are a lot of people on Earth are Semites. Yeah? And when we have this consciousness, it's possible to make peace together. So it's I don't know the English word for that, but it's your part on our part and at the end. And so we come together, and that makes a peace. And we will see that we are brothers, and that's, in my opinion, will open up the mind for someone this way.
All right, cover anti-Semitism report on Amazon right now.
Yes.
Worldwide shipping, Amazon Prime.
Amazon. So
Nation Ephraim anti-Semitism report from darkness to light.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So get your book and join the crew.
This is the 10th book we published within 4 years. So the original Antisemitismus report in German is the 8th publication, and I, as a publisher, has to say, okay, if you want to get familiar with our topics and you want to know what's going on, so this is the best book to buy. So we have a lot of books. We have books about the laws. We have books about letters that were written to really important persons, so I can... every book you buy is really important. So we have some books about church stuff. We have some books, the English translation would be Who is Israel? We have a book of Revelation. So if you see the Revelation, the book of Revelation, so you have a time period. And we tried to give pictures, so what happened, what really happened. So the Bible is really a book that talks in pictures. So the difference between the Christians was that they made really pictures and say, hey, look at the picture, this is a picture, but you shall not do this. So what we did, we took the time period. So when you have a prophecy about something, and you know the prophecy just when the prophecy was fulfilled. So there are a lot of things, okay, who's the Antichrist, who's the dragon, who's the false prophet. So if you have a revelation about that, who really the person is, you can go back, take the prophecy, and you can give them a real image. So the prophet saw maybe a vision, so it was maybe today you would say, okay, someone took some LSD pills. So it was really something you just have tried, but they kind of had a few in our time today. So if you read prophecies all over the Bible from the beginning to the end, they all end in this really special time. So, but today we have a photo, so we can take a picture in a newspaper. There are pictures from events the prophets have seen. So we have made a book with some news cuts, so to say, always with the idea to show, okay, what did the prophets really see. So we have a lot of books, and this is the best of all to come in, because that's our case. So we are, like we said, non-Jews, but because we said we want to stay with the Jewish people, we want to stay with the state of Israel, we want to keep Torah, we got the whole package of anti-Semitism against non-Jews. So we made this book, and there is our personal case, but there are really good things, basic understanding and context, and some biblical things to get smooth into the topic. And almost all of it was written by our brilliant author, Patrick.
And last thing I would say is that if we're talking about prophecy, the Rebbe, one of the main things the Rebbe says, and he says it as a prophet, and I can explain that at length, maybe at a different time, but the Rebbe says that he brings the Yalkut Shemayim, which is a pirush on certain portions of the Tanakh. And the Yalkut Shemayim is 1,000 years old, and it speaks about the Muslims fighting, and there's a lot of wars in the Muslim world, and there's going to be a point when people are going to be running, and they're going to say, we don't know where to go. So usually when there's a war on one side of the world, you go to the other side. But today we have a situation that is called Lahechal Nave Menelech. Where should we go? Nobody knows. It's like the whole world is suffering at the same exact moment. Nobody feels like they have a good idea of what to do. And at that moment, Hashem comes and he says, my humble ones, that's the way he calls them, the humble ones, that we spoke about how important being humble is. Anavim, humble ones, don't be worried, don't be scared. Everything I'm doing only for you. Do not fear, the time of your redemption has arrived. This is the prophecy that the Rebbe brought from the Yalkut Shemayim, but he says it today, and the Rebbe, this is one of the things that, you know, certain topics the Rebbe said once and by. Certain topics the Rebbe kept, you know, saying them again and again for 2 years straight, like, what's the deal? Right? Of course, after the Rebbe, at the time, there was the Gulf War, and then there was Gaddafi and this and that, and all the Muslim countries, one after the other, started falling like dominoes after that. And so that's like an example. I mean, it's probably not in the book because it's different prophets, different prophecies. But that's an example of modern-day prophecy, and we do know that before Mashiach comes, prophecy comes back to Israel, comes back to the world. So it's not something far-fetched, it's something that lines up with Judaism and with the ending. All right, with that we shall shalom till next time.
Shalom.
And see you later.
Bye. Thank you very much for listening, and I hope we see us soon again.
Subscribe, like.
Bye-bye.